We had a record year in 2018 where we saw about $100 billion worth transactions getting signed. And the defining theme was that there were a majority of control deals. I just want to highlight two things. Over the last few years, we have seen a rise in control transactions, but last year, a lot of companies ended up selling what they call their crown jewels. And we had promoters acknowledging publicly that they were probably not the natural owners of their businesses. We had Analjit Singh saying that at a press conference. So, you know, so we have three veteran deal makers here. KKR is Rupen Jhaveri. KKR struck $1 billion worth deals in private equity and control transactions last year. Gaurav Ahuja of Chris Capital. Chris Capital has just closed its eighth fund, and they had two large transactions. They exited Liquid Hub to Capgemini last year, and they also made a deal in Gebs Healthcare Solutions. We'll have Gaurav speaking about that. And Raghubir Menon of Shardul Amarchand, a senior M&A leader. He's also an advisor to Walmart, and he's looked at M&A and PE from across various, advising players on also across the aisle. So, if I can invite all of you to, make your opening remarks on how you've seen the nature of the control transactions evolve over the last decade, and especially what was different about 2018 that we had a record number of transactions. Raghubir?
Sure. I think just taking a step back, what we've started seeing over the last couple of years, and especially 2018, is a culmination of a lot of years of history for the Indian economy as well as for the private equity industry in India itself. So if you take India back to 10 years, 15 years before this, it's always primarily been a growth economy market. Deal sizes have been smaller. Right. Businesses which have been available for investment have also been much smaller. As the economy itself has matured, along with that, you've seen this new wave of entrepreneurs who have come up, the professionally managed companies, and promoters themselves are hitting second gen, third gen, with their own related succession issues. So opportunities have increased, I would say, and you're seeing the results of the opportunities over the last couple of years. So it's not as if 2018 has been a game changer. The game has been changing very, very slowly, and you're seeing the culmination of that in the last year or maybe the year before. In addition, another fact which is there is private equity in India is still a very young industry. So if you're talking about 2010, a Rupin or a Gaurav who are sitting here, were looking at deals with a very, very different lens from the manner in which they would be looking at the same transactions today. And as opportunities have grown, as the GP comfort with India, with assets, managing companies has grown, they've also gravitated from going from minority transactions, growth equity, to looking at positions where they can exercise a lot more control. And I think that's a part of the second stage of the discussion and not something I'll go into now, but hand over.
What has your experience been, Gaurav?
So the way to, the way we would think about it is, and the way we've experienced it is that, to Raghuveer's point, 10 years ago, there were fewer opportunities. It was largely a minority market. And if you really think about why a control deal emerges, right, and you contrast it to the US, you have a slow growth environment, you have a professional management, you don't have any one single majority shareholder, many of these companies are listed, and there may be leverage on these companies, right? So these are all things that lend themselves to control situations. No one's hanging on to all the shareholding, businesses are not growing 15-20% a year, so you're not really fussed about selling them and maybe cashing out and starting something new. That all of these dynamics were missing in India, right? Businesses were unlevered, growth was fantastic. There was a strong promoter group. And because of that, you were not seeing too many control opportunities. Today, what we see is that, you know, there are much higher control opportunities. Growing from a smaller base, majority of the market would still be minority. But what you're seeing is genuine succession issues. So you are seeing, you know, the next generation want to do something different, and that throws up an opportunity. You're seeing situations in which the parent is distressed, but they may have a subsidiary which is extremely well run, and, you know, kicking and screaming, they need to sell that subsidiary to delever at the parent level. You're seeing situations where promoters and management teams are coming up to us and saying, look, you know, we've kind of taken the business to the, you know, highest place, you know, that we could take it to, but now we really need a management upgrade. We need a sponsor to come in and help us to take it to the next level. So you're seeing all of these trends which are opening up a lot of control opportunities, you know, for sponsors in India.
We can get Rupen to...
Just to add to what's already been said, you know, at least what we feel, the reasons that the control environment or control deal environment has come about, three or four. I think the IBC has been a real game changer. Gaurav alluded to the leverage part, but it may not necessarily be the assets that are sold in IBC, because that, at least in the first wave, is perhaps going more to the strategic players or the existing competitors. But that has led to other crown jewels, and you mentioned that in your opening remarks, being sold. In fact, a couple of our deals in the last 2 years have come about because of this, where the entrepreneur had to sell off a couple of the assets, which otherwise they would have never dreamt of. But they had larger interests of the group in mind. And I think this trend is going to only accelerate. What we've seen in IBC is only a start of a huge number of assets that are coming through. Second, you know, 10 years ago or 15 years ago when we were doing private equity, as Raghubir mentioned, you ask somebody, is your company up for sale, they laugh at it. I think having that chairman title on the card was extremely important from a society standpoint, from a personal standpoint, from a network standpoint. At least we see that changing quite a lot. I think people are saying, okay, at the right price or for the right reasons, I'm willing to sell. So that actually has created a lot of opportunities, we think, in the last 2-3 years. Third, and this is both good and bad, we're seeing a lot of second generation entrepreneurs. While their parents may have built the business, but the second generation doesn't necessarily want to come in the business. They want to do something on the technology side, something in the family office, move to London, whatever the case may be. Now that's good, because that probably leads to succession issues and they want to sell the business, but I worry from a country standpoint, because who the hell is going to build the next steel plant, cement plant, aluminum plant? But jokes aside, and the last one, we are seeing the reason for some of these transactions is that there's shareholder pressure and there's board pressure. All these conglomerates over the years has become so complicated. You know, they may have one or two crown jewels who generate 20-25% return on capital, but the rest of them are sucking wind. And on a consolidated basis, they may be single digit. No one really was questioning that. I think with the advent of advisory firms, proxy firms, different management coming in, different board members coming in, it's very early, but I do think that over time, this will also lead to people divesting some non-core assets, assets where they can't spend enough time on, etc. So combination of these four, in different degrees of the evolution, is leading to an environment that we're seeing.
Okay. Thank you for those remarks. If I can ask you all to kind of identify your bidder strategies, you know, when you all are bidding for these assets, control deals, what are the best ways that you've seen? What are the best consortium deals that leads to successful bids, rather? Are you looking at partnering with strategics, SAP firms, or how's the experience of going up against strategics themselves for some of these assets? How's that experience been?
So, at least in our experience, fortunately, we didn't have to, or not fortunately, thus far we haven't necessarily partnered with strategics. I think it's a function of why you need that. Typically two reasons. One is either capital, or they bring something to the table that you don't have. For us, capital thus far hasn't been really an issue. So yes, we do compete with them. So maybe I'll address that point. Look, I don't think we have the crystal ball to know what is the right price or what to pay, what not to. I mean, only time will tell whether we are right or wrong. what we focus on, and you ask what success is what can you do with the asset? And we were speaking outside before this, is what's changed in the last few years if you're doing control deals? It's not like a minority deal where you're backing the horse being the entrepreneur, and hoping that they do the right things. I think in a control deal, like it happens worldwide in the Western geographies, enough time has to be spent upfront during the deal diligence or signing to closing, where you think about management, where you think about operating levers, where you think about changes that you have to make, whether it's capital structure, management structure, whatever the case may be. And you need to have confidence to drive that, and because you're in control, hopefully you have the ability to do it. I think all that will determine the price that you can pay. I think headline prices sometimes are very deceptive. Oh, this person paid this, this person paid that. But frankly, the reality is that a lot of times people have paid more, but they've generated even more because they had conviction in the operating case. In our case, one example was a tire company that we bought. We were actually the highest bidder because it was an auction process. But we were very clear about the 8 to 10 operating levers that we had in the business, and then you just rigorously focus on those, which can create an outsized outcome for you.
Yeah, if I can just add to that. So I think, look, it depends on a case-by-case basis and, you know, what the competitive universe looks like. Obviously, the advantages of partnering with a strategic is that, and Rupin may dispute this, but there is a higher likelihood of winning the deal just because, you know, they have synergies and other things that they can bake into it. You come straight into an operating business. So, you know, as long as you like what the strategic has, the strengths they have operationally, you know, that can get you off the ground a lot quicker. Makes the whole proposition less riskier. The disadvantage is that, you know, the exit mechanism is very complicated because they're in it halfway, you're in it halfway. You know, do you sell back to them? How do you get a fair price? Do you sell to another strategic that might be a competitor for them? They may block that. So, you know, you need, Raghuveer can probably talk a little bit more about this, but you need a robust structure to get out, right? Also, your horizon is very different. You know, strategics and entrepreneurs will typically have a much, much longer horizon compared to sponsors. So that can also be a challenge. They may want to invest behind the business. You may want to, you know, optimize margins, and so you're misaligned. And lastly, you know, given the complication on the exit, I would imagine it would be better to do it yourself, as a KKR does, as we have done in the past, where, you know, you have a smaller horse that's running at a very fast speed, and so the IRR and the ROI potential could be significantly higher, you know, versus partnering with a strategic, and then you're coming at the parent level making this acquisition. So I think those are the pros and cons of partnering with a strategic. Partnering with another GP is a good way to go about it as well. The benefit is, one, you reduce the competition for the deal. Two is you have another set of eyes and ears, another smart investor that's kicking the tires alongside you. And so, you know, overall the process is a lot, underwriting process is a lot more robust.
I think just picking up on a couple of things which Gaurav said, I think something very interesting is around the horizons themselves for the investment. And also, if you look at the nature of transactions which have happened over the past few years and where he has gone on its own versus partnering with a strategic, it's a certain kind of PE who has typically partnered with a strategic, whereas there is a certain kind of PE who's gone on its own. And I think that tells a lot on that private equity player itself, the operational strength, their comfort with the industry, where they're investing into, etc. Now, one of the points which Rupin was mentioning about having a handle on the operational levers of the business, when you're owning a business entirely on your own, the ability to bring synergies about, whether from your global portfolio, whether from bringing in more experienced management, the ability to drive the process is very, very different from where you're partnering with someone. One of the key issues which you tend to have when you're partnering with a strategic also is the fundamental view on pricing of the transaction. And I remember having these very interesting conversations just after the Lafarge deal happened, where when there was a lot of interest from the PE guys who started pulling from the process, the moment they started seeing the strategic players in there. And when the price for the deal got announced, I remember talking to one of the biggest cement players in the country. They said, that's a good price. And we were acting for one of the PE consortiums who put club together. And they said, we wouldn't have come near that price with a barge pole. So just a very different lens on the horizon of that asset. You're looking for exit at 5, 7, 8 years, the margins out of the business. It's a very different view as compared to what a strategic would take.
That's interesting. Gaurav, if I can bring you in, can you throw some light on the LP view? How is it partnering with LPs on some of these control deals? And how has their view in general changed?
So, you know, I would start with a very high-level statement, which is, I think, all else equal, LPs and GPs would prefer control deals, right? You'd always, if you have the ability at the right valuation, you want to be able to control the direction of the company, the management team, your exit, all of those things, right? In general, you want to be in control of your destiny. So there will always be a preference, right? Now, the reason why control is still small is because of some of the reasons that we've spoken about. And, you know, at least, you know, as an investment firm, our view is, you know, we'll do both minority as well as control. We're comfortable doing both. The opportunity has to make sense for us. If you just look at one or the other, then you are essentially restricting your investable universe, right? So all else equal, control is preferred, right? And that goes down to the LP level when it comes to co-investments as well. There are many LPs who have indicated that they would only like to be co-investors in a control situation, right? So there is definitely a strong preference on that side.
If we can move to you know, the next part of the discussion, which is structures. Over the last 2 years, we've seen PE firms, you know, build platforms to kind of acquire businesses further. How's that experience been, Rupin, if you can start off with? And what are the challenges in executing this sort of a deal once you've made the platform?
Maybe at a generic level, you know, at least our view is that it sounds very great to say that let's build a platform and we'll do bolt-on acquisitions and we'll make it bigger. The practical experience has been, I would say, tough for most people. The reality is that we don't have that many scaled assets in the country. And again, this view will differ GP by GP. I think depending on what scale you're looking to build, depending on the size of the fund, your appetite, etc. Our view has been that instead of just committing capital and then trying to find assets on the back of a management, see if you can have one basic asset to start with. Okay, if you have some small mid-sized asset to start with and use that as a beachhead to then go make acquisitions, it's easier. We do have one platform investment, and honestly, it's been, while the economic outcome may be okay, but if I just look at the time adjusted return on capital, frankly, it's not worth it. And that's a, and Raghubir knows this on deals we worked with, that's an important measure we use all the time. Okay, you can make 20% on this deal or 30% on that, but you've got to look at the time you spend on these deals also, because that's an opportunity cost. So for us, I think at least, and maybe this is the fund bias, we try to avoid platform deals. We don't mind backing a company on asset. We did a healthcare deal recently, which was we backed a company and then we did a transformative acquisition. Now time will tell whether we are successful or not, but that's okay. But if we just gave X million dollars to somebody, go find hospitals or go find this diagnostic center, we find that a bit more challenging, at least in our construct. But maybe there are differing views.
In fact, just to pick up on what Rupin said very, very briefly, what we've seen is two kinds. One is the tuck-ins, which Rupin is talking about. And you need to look at it also from the lens of the sector. A lot of sectors, there'll be one good company, but being able to add on is very, very difficult.
Right.
Where we have seen a little bit of success is where you've actually been able to build a platform from scratch. So something like renewables, where you just need a good management team. You don't really need to look for good assets. If those assets come about, it's opportunistic. But you've had a bunch of funds who have, from scratch, built out renewable assets, whether in solar or wind, and then sold them on to strategics. So it's, again, not a one solution fits all kind of sectors. But depending on the sector and the opportunity, you could tailor something together.
No, so I actually fully agree with Rupen. I think it's hard to start from scratch. There are lots of execution challenges in India. Gestation periods are very long. So, nothing wrong with evaluating a platform opportunity, but, Chris Capital would also look at a larger business, right, to get started, and then use that as the platform to make more acquisitions. There's lots of challenges. You have obviously integration challenges. Cultures could be very different. There could be management team churn. And, as a sponsor, you could be overestimating the kind of synergies and the cross-sell and the upsell that you expect. You could be overestimating all of those things as well. So the fewer, with every acquisition that you do, the risk goes up, right? So better to start with a chunky bit and then, add on to that.
Just tied into this, actually, I wanted some of your thoughts on management teams, the importance of management teams, and how different is it when you do a management buyout, and what are the challenges in those kind of situations? Because as a controlling stakeholder, you are in charge of the asset pretty much, so you'd probably be looking at execution as well. So if you can.
Sure. I think the answer will depend sector by sector. I think in this country you'll see that some of the services industry, whether it is IT services, and I'm sure Gaurav will talk because they've had good success there, healthcare to some extent, and financial services, actually there's reasonable professional talent available. So you could theoretically go buy a business, even if it's an entrepreneur-run business, have your own management if you don't like what's on the offer, and still be okay. I'm not sure you can extend that argument to, and I'm being generic right now, to most other sectors, because A, I don't think the professional talent exists at that level. You may have great factory heads, you may have great production heads, quality heads, sales head, but at that strategic level, the C-suite level, we actually struggle. So then the model we think has to be find an investment where the entrepreneur is willing to continue till the time you find somebody in a minority position, as long as some of the softer aspects of a transaction can be handled. And we've done it successfully in three of our transactions, because they just didn't yield themselves to get leaders in those sectors. That being said, at the functional level, I think across the industries we're able to find. So whether it is the operational head or finance heads in particular, I think it is very important for most GPs to have a roster of people with them. Tomorrow, if you're going to have buyouts in all these industries, it cannot be an afterthought that I'll do my management assessment after I buy the company and then I'll figure out what the changes are. This is an equally important diligence item for us. We do management assessments upfront. You put your org charts upfront. Who's staying, who's not. Who are the five people on your speed dial you can call in a cement asset, I'm making it up, aluminum asset, healthcare asset, etc. And I was saying this in my opening remarks that this is going to be a differentiating factor for buyouts going forward. Your operating capabilities, your ability to bring in management and make that change upfront. Our founder keeps saying, and he's made public statements, the biggest mistakes we made as a firm is where we haven't made the change fast enough when you're in control. It's people driven. You have the wrong person, he or she, in the saddle, and honestly, you just lose 1 to 3 years of the investment.
Gaurav, do you have any thoughts on that? Challenges of dealing with the management?
No, I fully agree with Rupen. I think you have to have a game plan before you go in. You need to know, not just have a game plan, you also have to have a backup plan. Look, it's always going to be challenging, right? You have to calibrate a lot. The new team that's coming in is going to be untested in that particular scenario. They may have come from a larger IT services firm coming into a smaller IT services firm. So how do you ensure that they are successful in the new environment? You may ruffle some feathers with the existing management team. They may be frustrated that, the CEO or the leader was not internally, chosen from the internal team. Culture, especially in businesses like IT services, which is very, very people-driven, culture is a big, big concern, right? So you have to make sure that you're bringing in the right person. And the only way to ensure success is to answer all of these questions before you actually do the deal. Because if you start doing this post-deal, you're going to lose 12 months, 18 months, maybe even 24 months, and that is a massive hit on your IRR.
In fact, that's absolutely correct. It's one of your key diligence items is looking at and deciding on management. And as Gaurav said, you need to layer in a number of things. Not just, are you happy with current management? Are you looking to reset? And if so, what is the right time to reset? In fact, one of the discussions we typically have with funds at the investment stages, how do you incentivize management? So that becomes a very, very important discussion. Of course, it's a very different consideration for public listed companies versus private companies where you're going control. But over the years, and you've seen this multiple times, even in the large listed control deals which have happened, whether it's a Hexaware or Emphasis, the incentivization of management in a way they see their own growth in a PE-driven company becomes very important.
We're actually running out of time, but I definitely want to hear your thoughts on some of these regulatory challenges that have, come up. Raghubir, especially, in light of the e-commerce norms, do you sense strategics getting wary about India? And, I mean, this is going to impact exits, obviously, 2-3 years down the line. So what are your thoughts on that?
So if you'd asked me this question 5 years back, I'd have said, yes, India has a lot of regulatory challenges, contract interpretation, et cetera, et cetera. And we've spoken about these multiple times. I think India is a very different environment today. Yes, you will have certain knee-jerk reactions. You will have certain things which rock the boat. But I think the basic bolts are in place. Now, you have Press Note 2, which has come about, but it's reacting to a certain fact situation. It's reacting to what is happening in the marketplace. I think the way policy has evolved, regulation has evolved, and the level of comfort which, say, private equity today has in India with the law, statute, dispute resolution is very, very different compared to 5 years back. You will have the odd instances, you'll always have the odd instances, but I think this is the case where the exception will prove the rule rather than the other way around.
Rupin, do you have any thoughts on that?
You know, when we assess companies, we think about management risk, we think about demand supply risk, we think about execution risk. I think it's equally important to think through regulatory risk. The reality is that you don't know, and that's why it's regulatory risk. So the idea is that, A, try to avoid industries which are highly regulatory intensive. So I think great examples are perhaps services business where, well, that's not true anymore given Donald Trump. But
right. Point
is, generally speaking, they're not that regulatory heavy. So there are enough industries where you can pick and choose. And secondly is have margin of safety or buffer. I think the reality is that what happens in our country is not a surprise. You look back 20 years, we take three steps back, we take three steps forward, two steps back. So there's no magic formula to price that in, because I think I don't think anyone knows that. But if you can leave enough buffer in the purchase price that you're paying or the assumptions that you made, hopefully there is a bit of cushion if something untoward happens, because it is going to happen in some of these industries.
I mean, I would completely agree. I think, look, we've been investing in India for 20 years now. When we first started investing, we had BJP in power, then we got 2 terms of Congress, now we're back to BJP, and now we're back to looking forward to uncertain times. So, and we've had a share of, lessons learned, investing in sectors like infrastructure and so on, where there is a lot of regulatory oversight. Basically, any industry where you need government approvals or clearances or anything that's any of those sort of things, we've tried to stay clear of them, right? You look at IT services, more of a Donald Trump issue versus a, Indian government issue. You look at, consumer, very, very disparate, not that much. It's more consumer-driven, more, retail-driven, so you don't see too much there. And pharma, a little bit here or there, with the DPCO and the NLEM, but nothing more, specific than that. Financial services is the one where, we do see more regulation, but there the regulator is quite strong. So we do like the kind of oversight they're providing. So we've just tried to stay away from some of these sectors where the government could change your destiny.
So we are nearly out of time. If I can invite you all to, make a prediction for this year, what is one key sector that you all think will see maximum number of control deals, or which is going to be the most active sector in your view? You feel comfortable talking about it?
I mean, if you just look at current trends from January, financials is a sector where there has been a lot of activity and a lot of control transactions already. And in India, financials and IT, ITS have been the target sector for control always. And I think the reasons which both Gaurav and Rupin were saying, the ease of regulation or in the alternate regulation, which keeps things in line, gives a lot of comfort to the PE industry.
I fully agree with Raghubir. I think there have been some industry events that have happened that are leading to more deal flow and accelerated deal flow in some of these sectors. So, I would imagine those would be the two big sectors.
Okay. In addition to what's been said, which I agree, probably healthcare.
Right.
If you look at the various segments of healthcare, each one is going through its own spate of issues,
right,
which is leading to consolidation for a variety of reasons. So, that's a prediction.